Welcome everyone to the 23rd meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I have received apologies from Emma Harper this morning. We have two members joining us online as well, but other than that, everyone is here. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed, thank you. And our second item today is a further evidence session as part of our inquiry into health inequalities. During the session today, the committee will be undertaking a roundtable session and discussion with witnesses to explore possible solutions at a policy level that can sustain focus and action on tackling health inequalities across portfolio. And I'd like to welcome to the committee Dr. Peter Cosson, the Principal GP of GPs at the Deep End, Professor Sir Michael Marmot, Professor of Epidemiology at the University College London, Dr. Shirley McDade, Head of Evidence and Impact for Scotland and Northern Ireland for the Mental Health Foundation, and Professor Petra Meyer, Director of the UK PRP-funded Cypher Consortium. And I believe that all of you have a brief opening statement to make before we start our discussion. So I can take you in the order in which I've introduced you, and if we come to Dr. Cosson first.
Hello, good morning, and thank you very much for inviting me here. And I just clarify that I'm not the principal GP of GPs at the Deep End. I'm a GP principal. I'm just one GP amongst many GPs at the Deep End, but thank you. I'm a GP at Gruscadden-Byrne Medical Practice in Drumchapel. It's one of the so-called deep end practices, which is a term that was coined by Professor Graham Watt to describe practices in which the majority of patients live in postcodes classified as highly deprived by the Scottish Index for multiple deprivation. And there's 100 practices characterised, or roughly 100 practices characterised like that. And about 50% of postcodes classified as highly deprived are registered with those practices. I joined my GP practice because I had a deep conviction that general practice and primary care can make a difference to health inequalities. I joined just before my first son was born, and he's now 23. So I've been a very long time working in Drumchapel. The other witnesses here are much better qualified than I am to speak about how health inequalities are defined. But I'd just briefly like to speak to what health inequality means at an emotional level. If nothing else, I've spent 23 years witnessing the impact of health inequality on people's lives day in, day out. And health inequalities for me is somewhere between a sense of meaningless and a sense of rage. I think that there's a constant labour of not tipping over into hopeless resignation or angry bitterness. That's something I've witnessed in my own life over 23 years in my colleagues and also more than anything in the community that I serve. I'm not going to speak to individual examples of how health inequalities have impacted on individuals because I don't want to sensationalise people's experiences. But one of the most soul-destroying things for myself as a health professional has been to witness on a daily basis how the National Health Service, sometimes unwittingly, sometimes deliberately, and in many ways, widens health inequalities and perpetuates divisions. And that's something which I hope we can discuss today. But what I do want to briefly mention is why I still am idealistic and believe that we can make a difference. And I just want to give three examples of things that have kept me hopeful, if not optimistic, after nearly a quarter of a century working in my practice. The first has been seeing the difference that good general practice and primary care can make to health inequalities. That can be through willingness to sit and listen and be an ally and an advocate to people, giving them the time to try and understand what is going on in their lives and try to help them find a way through. And if there is no way of finding a way through, of still sitting with them and being willing to listen and not to pretend they don't exist. At a very practical level, taking the time to explain and to allay fears, to understand fears and to help people, for example, go for a test that they're afraid of. taking the time to support people through bereavement, even when that bereavement is tragically at an early age, and something that's quite helping someone to die who is younger than yourself, something that we have all working in areas like Drum Chapel have to do on a regular basis. And that's something which we can't turn away from and can make a difference in helping people go through that. And then in a really practical, nitty-gritty way, through something called safety netting, where we simply make lists of people that we think won't turn up for tests, won't go for chest x-ray, won't go for appointments, to find out whether they've gone and to follow them up and to try and encourage them to go. Or responding to letters to saying that people haven't attended, not just by filing them away, but by phoning up and discussing with them the reasons why they haven't attended. All of these little actions are like, feel like little pebbles thrown into a huge sea of inequality. But I believe that first of all, they help to keep us feeling that we do something meaningful and something worthwhile. But above all, I think that if they're scaled up on a large scale, that primary care and general practice can make a difference to health inequalities. Second example I'd like to give is my own practice was a lead practice for the Community Link Worker Pilot Program a number of years ago. And one of the transformative effects for that for us was to try to become a more community-linked practice. Just for example, we had a day when we had a sports day in the practice. And what that meant was that we had a treasure hunt around the community where we went to meet all the places in Drum Chapel where people can go for physical activity and to learn about how all these little community centres, little gym, boxing clubs, dancing clubs, how much they transform people's lives. So over the past 7 years, we've been trying to become a more community-linked practice to understand that as medical practitioners, we can make the most difference to people's lives if we work alongside the practice, the community where we work, if we help people to access all the resources that are there. Now, many of those resources are very fragile and many of them have disappeared. But I still believe that a strong general practice and primary care supported by a community that has a lot of resources for well-being can make a huge difference. And the community link workers in our practice have really helped us to help our patients and individuals find resources and assets in the community to help them. And just finally, I'd like to speak about a third reason why I feel optimistic. Many years ago, one of our practice nurses approached us because she was felt frustrated and disillusioned with years of telling people that they needed to make lifestyle changes, knowing fine well that they didn't have the resources or the possibility to make those changes. So she asked if she could start a small group to help people help one another to make changes. That was about 5 or 6 years ago, and that group was called Chance to Change. Since then, that group has gone on to develop and grow and has had a really transforming effect on the lives of the people that take part in it. It's no longer run by a practice nurse, it's now run by a peer facilitator. And that group has now joined with the Scottish Government to try and find solutions to the problems that the inquiry is tackling today. So over the past year, I've been a member of the Scottish Government Short Life Working Group on Primary Care Health Inequalities, and Chance to Change have been an expert reference group to that work. And they've had the opportunity both to feed into the recommendations that that work has made and also to provide their own report commenting on the recommendations. It's been a frightening process for me as a GP in that it's put me, most of the members are patients in our practice, and they haven't held back in terms of expressing how the last few years have impacted them, including some pretty sharp criticisms of ourselves. We're not holding ourselves out to be any better or any different to the rest of the NHS. But I very much deeply believe that we can find solutions if we work together in this way. But I'd just like to finally highlight a few things from that process. From the Short Life Working Group, there are 5 key recommendations. One of these is to have a strong process of national leadership, which I believe this inquiry is helping to provide. Second is around providing the resources for general practice and primary care teams to do the kind of actions that I've already outlined and more in terms of changing how we work and being able to mitigate and change the process of health inequalities. And that includes training up people to understand how health inequalities impact on people. But more than anything, I think the recommendations are looking at supporting long-term wellbeing communities around primary care and addressing the barriers that are particularly the NHS puts up that widen divisions and perpetuate health inequalities. We need to research and understand what those barriers are and address the structural discrimination and inequality that exists in the NHS. But from Towns to Change themselves, they've brought forward, they're doing a project in digital inclusion and helping each other to learn how to use digital technology so that they can access some of the benefits that that's going to bring in the years ahead. And I think that has to be an important strategy to help people. Digital access is now a determinant of health, and there needs to be a strong program to help people to access digital technology. But more than anything, Chance to Change have emphasised how relationships are at the heart of health inequalities. And in particular, they've spoken to how they so often feel excluded and disrespected and not listened to. And so they've very strongly spoken to the reality of needing to have a health service that puts them at the centre. So I'd just like to finish by saying that so often equity has been talked about as if it's a zero-sum game, as if to help people who are excluded, we have to disadvantage those who are better off or those who already have access to health services. And I don't believe that. I think that if we design the health service around people like Chance to Change, so that it's accessible and respectful of them and brings them into the heart of how the health service works, then we will have a health service that functions properly and that functions well and that actually makes a difference to health inequalities. So I'm very pleased to be here today, and I hope that our conversation can help us to find practical policies and approaches to making that a reality. Thanks very much for inviting me.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And can I come to Professor Marmot, please?
Yes, thank you. And it's a pleasure to be able to talk to you this morning. Excuse me. In thinking about health inequalities, let me say at first, much of my analyses have been for England, but all the evidence suggests that what we say about England applies to Scotland and to Wales even more so. And I have less evidence from Northern Ireland, but all the evidence suggests that, as I said, what I say about England applies to Scotland even more so. And I want to talk about three phases in thinking about health inequalities. The first is what happened after 2010. The second is the pandemic, and the third is the cost of living crisis. So if we take the first, what happened after 2010? In England, I did the so-called Marmot Review, Fair Society, Healthy Lives. We had six domains of recommendations of what you need to do to address health inequalities, and they were: give every child the best start in life. Number two, education and lifelong learning. Number three, employment and working conditions. Number four, everyone should have at least the minimum income necessary for a healthy life. Number five, healthy and sustainable basis. And our review of the evidence suggested that if those six domains of recommendations were followed, health would improve and health inequalities would diminish. In February 2020, on the 10-year anniversary of my 2010 review, we published Health Equity in England, the Marmot Review 10 Years On, just before the pandemic crashed upon us. And what we documented was that life expectancy had more or less stopped improving. Inequalities, the social gradient, classify people by where they live and classify where they live by level of deprivation. There's a social gradient that had got steeper, and that was true in Scotland as well as in England. And thirdly, life expectancy for the poorest people had gone down, got worse. And that was true in Scotland as it was in England. And dramatically, if you look at the English data, and my colleagues from Glasgow assure me it's the same in Glasgow, look at the index of multiple deprivation. You see a social gradient, but that gradient is steeper in the north of England than it is in London and the south. And it's steeper in Glasgow than it is in the south of England. In other words, a national index of multiple deprivation has more severe consequences for health in the north of England and in Scotland than it does in London and in the southeast. It's more extreme in parts of Scotland. Then came the pandemic. And the pandemic exposed and amplified the underlying inequalities in society. What we saw, and the Scottish data were identical to the English data, what we saw is the social gradient in mortality from COVID-19 was almost exactly parallel to the social gradient in mortality from all causes. Slightly steeper in Scotland and in England for COVID-19 than for all causes. But what it means is that the causes of inequality in COVID were very similar to the causes of inequalities in health more generally. Yes, we have to control the virus, but we also have to deal with the inequality. And when we compare England, Scotland, Northern Ireland, Wales, with other countries, the fall in life expectancy in 2020 and 2021 was steeper than in any other country except the United States. When they say the Prime Minister got the big decisions right, when it comes to COVID, that's not what the evidence shows. Our fall and Scotland's fall in life expectancy was actually slightly steeper than England in 2020 and 2021. And for England, and I think the data are similar for Scotland, in the triennium 2018-19-20, compared with the previous triennium, we saw a fall in life expectancy, not just in the poverty. And I asked myself, why in these islands, why in the United Kingdom, did we do so poorly in health pre-pandemic and then manage the pandemic so poorly? What's the link? And I've suggested the link could act at four levels: poor governance and political culture, the second is increasing social and economic inequalities. The third is the disinvestment from public services. And the fourth was that we weren't very healthy coming into the pandemic. And then we have the cost of living crisis. As I'm sure you know well, that inflation of 10% has a much bigger impact on households at low income than households at high income, because food and energy make up a higher proportion of the expenditure of low income households. So an overall inflation of 10% means something like 8% for households in the top decile of earnings and 14% for households in the bottom decile earnings. And when we look back at why life expectancy failed to improve and health inequalities got bigger in the decade after 2010. Child poverty went up. Poverty as a whole went up. Inequalities increased. As I said, disinvestment from public services. Looking at my 2010 recommendations, pretty well policy went in. And I've now added two to my six recommendations, the six that I laid out. And the two that I've added are to deal with structural racism, discrimination, and their consequences, and pursue the health inequalities agenda and the climate emergency at the same time. I would say we know what to do to reduce health inequalities. The evidence is quite strong that we could do it if we had the political will and the organization to do it. The fact that things have been going in the wrong direction is credible. It's understandable because policies have been going in the wrong direction. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I come to Dr. McDade?
Thank you. And thank you for this opportunity to speak to the committee. Mental health problems are what I will speak about on behalf of the Mental Health Foundation, whose work focuses on the prevention of mental health problems. And our work has embedded in it a strong inequalities lens. We know that mental health problems are not distributed equally across the population, and they're not simply a result of genetic or biological factors. The circumstances in which we are born, grow, live, and age profoundly affect our risk of developing a mental health problem. And societal risk factors present barriers to many people experiencing good mental health. Fundamentally, living in lower socioeconomic conditions, facing financial strain, or living in poverty, earning below the real living wage, working in precarious employment, these are key drivers of mental distress and poor mental health, which ends up then resulting in diagnoses of mental health problems. So is living in poor quality housing, in unsafe neighborhoods due to violence, prejudice, discrimination, having limited access to clean, safe, and green space. And being at risk of prejudice, bullying, and discrimination itself is another key risk factor. And this can arise as a result of being identified with a number of social statuses, such as being Black or a person of color, being a member of the LGBT plus community, being a refugee or asylum seeker, being disabled, or other social statuses, which then result in someone being a victim of bullying, harassment, or discrimination. Violence against women is another key risk factor for developing a mental health problem, violence against women and girls. Living with a long-term physical or mental health condition is also a risk factor. Now, we believe that actions to address the risks of developing a mental health condition and to reducing mental health inequalities need to be taken at three levels. We need structural measures, we need to strengthen community assets, and we need to increase the resilience of individuals and groups. Structural measures consist of actions to change the social and economic influences and reduce their impact on mental health problems. Things like reducing income inequality, poverty, unemployment, and precarious work, preventing domestic violence, preventing discrimination, and preventing homelessness. Measures to promote community assets, which we've heard from our DeepNGP, are very important. Include activities to increase social connectedness, to improve community environments and create community spaces, and to foster participation in community decision making. And then we do need measures at the individual level as well, in terms of educating people about how to look after their own mental health. Very importantly, about creating peer support opportunities and showing people how they can contribute to their own mental health and the mental health of communities and families. We need action at all three levels. It's really no good to put up a website that tells us during the pandemic to go for a walk to look after our mental health if we live in a neighborhood where it's not safe to go for a walk. So these are kind of the fundamental interrelationship between the three levels. Now, I would like to note that, you know, from our perspective, we are seeing positive steps by the Scottish government to reduce mental health inequalities, things like the doubling of the child payment this year and the prioritizing of child poverty in the recent spending review, some new benefits that will support people through the cost of living crisis. Though I think I noted that the low income winter heating assistance is just £50. So it looks a bit thin compared to what people are going to actually be coping with in their heating bills. Investing in the investment that's been made in increasing supports for women and girls who have experienced violence. I think it was £38 million in 2021-22. This is a significant investment, I think, to support a rapid response to people who women who've experienced violence. And then investing in community action to prevent mental health problems with the £21 million last year and £15 million this year for the community's mental health and well-being fund. So what we need to do is to build on these steps, to up the scale, to up the effort, to have real impact. And I'll give you just a handful of recommendations at this point. Ensuring that there is strong cross-departmental involvement in the new mental health strategy is key. We need concrete commitments from government directorates beyond the health directorate, because mental health happens outside of the health system, in people's lives, where they live, in their communities and environments. We need to ensure that the newly devolved Social Security Service, which is a very important development for Scotland, is non-stigmatizing, that everyone experiences a trauma-informed, respectful service in which is sensitive to mental health, as well as, of course, increasing the benefits to provide an adequate minimum income. We need those two together. It's actually not adequate to simply increase the money that people have in their pockets, because there is also shame and stigma that comes with being on a lower income. And we need to make sure that the experience of attaining that minimum income is non-stigmatizing and is respectful. We need to build the community infrastructure for prevention. So we need to reinvigorate those community spaces where people can gather, learn, and support each other. When I'm thinking about the cost of living in crisis and what has happened in cost of living crisis in the past, one of the first things that get cut is the library. And yet the public library is a very important social space for supporting people's well-being. We need to ensure that those link workers, like what is in place in Drumchapel, that the 1,000 link workers that are being put in place in Scotland have a priority for outreach to disadvantaged groups. That's very important, that they're not kind of stuck in GP services and not reaching out to communities that need them. We need to increase and continue increase that investment in community activity for prevention of mental health problems. And to sustain some of the good work that's come out of the COVID response program in terms of the Mental Health Equality, Human Rights and Equalities Forum, and the Scottish government's recently established Diverse Experiences Advisory Panel, which the foundation is very pleased to be hosting. We know that mental health problems cost the Scottish economy, that is, 8.8 billion pounds a year. And we know that many of those mental health problems are preventable. So there's a choice now for the government in the context of recovery from the pandemic and in the context of the cost of living crisis. Specific choices can make a difference to preventing mental health problems or to allowing those environmental circumstances to run rampant and leave people unprotected. Thank you.
Thank you. And a final opening statement from Professor Meyer.
How do you follow that? Thank you, Convener, for inviting me. You've now heard from many experts how health inequalities are so strongly linked to inequalities in wealth and influence. And you've heard how so many of the systems that impact on health inequalities are failing. Housing systems that don't provide affordable homes, a welfare system that does not prevent poverty, a food system that doesn't guarantee nutritious food at reasonable prices, an education system that doesn't provide equal access to high quality education. And finally, our healthcare system, as Peter so rightly pointed out, that is increasingly less accessible to those with the highest level of need, but without the energy to fight for their rights. This has now been aggravated by the public sector austerity of the last 10 years, as Michael pointed out, and then came Brexit, COVID, war in Europe, cost of living crisis. We seem to be in an era of very fast-paced change. We should not anticipate a return to stability. The climate crisis and increased competition for earth resources are likely to accelerate our economic and social transformation. So how do we deal with that uncertainty? And how can we get Scotland into a position of more resilience? I would argue that high levels of inequality, poverty, and an unhealthy population makes Scotland much less resilient to future challenges. We know that poor health affects all aspects of people's lives, whether it's our ability to enjoy life as a private individual, to be creative, or to contribute to society through work, caregiving, or volunteering our time for the common good. It's a tragedy that so many people spend their 50s and 60s in poor health. It's also a big problem for productivity and for public sector demand. To a large degree, our problem is not an ageing society, it's the premature loss of health. How we deal with the current challenges is therefore critical. Are we playing whack-a-mole with bits of support for whatever problem happens to be most urgent right now, whether it's ambulances or food prices or education gaps due to COVID? Or do we attempt a comprehensive change across the large number of systems all at the same time, which would require an all government sectors agreeing to work pretty much flat out, taking every opportunity to reduce inequalities, including in sectors that maybe are not currently considering inequalities or well-being to be within their portfolios. One way to approach systems change is to think back. What do we wish we'd put in place 30 years ago? What would have put us into a much better position now? What would have helped us develop and not lose an equitable education system, access affordable homes, good work for all, and so on? And importantly, what things are we doing now that we know we're going to be kicking ourselves for in 30 years' time? I think first we need a frank conversation. If you want to reduce inequalities, we can only do it in two ways. We can redistribute health, wealth, and power, or we can try to hold the top constant and bring up the rear, levelling up. Levelling up, of course, is politically much more palatable. We don't reduce services in better off areas or raise taxes, so we can reallocate resources to disadvantaged communities. But the money for levelling up needs to come from somewhere, and that somewhere is really important. It can't just be some minor shuffling around of public sector budgets. If we have growth or opportunities for more big efficiency savings, then we can use that money strategically. But that's not the situation we're in. But however we do it, inequality reduction can't happen without sizable investment. As an example, I'm from Germany. Since reunification, over 30 years ago, Germany has invested 2 trillion euros, or 70 billion euros a year, to bridge the East-West inequalities. Much of this through levelling up, But since 1991, this has also included redistribution in form of a pretty hefty additional income tax of between 5% and 7%, the so-called solidarity tax. So back to Scotland. I think the unfairness in health inequalities and the health outcomes is appalling. There is nothing more precious than life. But we need to have that conversation, how much we really want to reduce health and other inequalities. If we are serious, then we need to work out where we want to redistribute and where we want to level up. If you want to redistribute, then look across all the ways in which government influences people's lives, and especially the way we fund public services. Identify inequalities in provision and reprioritise according to the needs of current and our future generations. Consider what can be done with taxes and levies on income, profits, wealth, land, property, luxury goods, and especially goods that damage our health or the environment. And for levelling up, where can extra money come from? I'm a public health expert, so not an economist, and others can talk much more knowledgeably about this, but what's the role of the Scottish National Investment Bank in health inequality? How can we involve businesses? Importantly, what is the role of public sector investment, not just in terms of paying real living wages, but across the board? How can we tweak incentive structures to get the good teachers, doctors, social housing and jobs to those who most need them? We need to make sure that we see the public sector investment not as a burden that needs to be minimised, but as an investment that can be optimised to deliver health, well-being and sustainability outcomes. And importantly, we need to take the public with us so they don't buy into a narrative of low tax and small state without realising the impact on the public services. So there is many things, I think, that the Scottish Government has control over. Some, of course, you can only influence through lobbying Westminster or after independence. And some, well, may well be political suicide. But any conversation, I think, needs to start from the enormous social, economic and environmental costs of health inequalities and how we can address them. Thank you.
Thank you. Lots from you there for us to sort of drill deeper on, and a really good start for our discussion. What's been very clear to us as we look at health inequalities, and we've been taking evidence for a number of weeks now, but of course we've all had an interest in this for some time as committee members. Health inequalities comes up all the time, no matter which inquiry you're doing, no matter which subject it is you're looking at in this committee. And of course it comes up in other committees as well because of the nature of the causes of health inequalities. Notwithstanding all you've said about whole systems and cross-portfolio working, I want to drill down on something that Dr. Costin said, which was about the NHS and the structures of the NHS perpetuating inequality and widening divisions, because that seems to me something that we need to hear more about. I wonder if I can come to Dr. Costin for more detail on that.
Yes, certainly. I think I absolutely have found the other contributions fascinating. And I think obviously the causes of health inequality and to a large extent the really big solutions lie outside the health service. Nevertheless, modern healthcare has now evolved to a stage where it has a significant impact both on whether someone develops premature disability and whether someone lives out their life in a healthy state or disabled or unwell. So access to particularly early intervention in healthcare can have a huge impact on whether someone becomes unwell or disabled in their 50s and 60s or whether they remain well. Again, that's not to diminish the importance, as others have pointed out, of childhood experiences and income and all the rest of it. But nevertheless, health services do have a significant impact. Now, health services were already struggling before the pandemic, and in my view, the pandemic has simply made that, has simply highlighted those weaknesses. But in many ways, the systems that are in place across the board, and I'm including my GP practice in this, I'm not setting myself apart, that the systems that are in place on the whole tend to be a one-size-fits-all approach, where you have to have a degree of ability to advocate for yourself and have competencies and abilities to navigate through the system in order to be able to access the service. There are many, many kind of small barriers in place that some people find insurmountable. The health service is a bit like the pavements in 1960s, that, you know, everyone has equal access as long as you're able to step up onto the pavement, but those that can't step up onto the pavement have no means of accessing. Just to give small examples, a referral to another service of a patient who had mental health problems and didn't open letters. They simply find letters threatening, and so they don't read them. So the referral that I made asked simply that the service would telephone with an appointment time rather than send a letter. And the referral was rejected on the basis that they're not that kind of service, that this is what they did and that was it. Patients turning up on the wrong day for an urgent suspected cancer chest x-ray referral to be turned away because they'd missed their appointment, even though the request was sitting there and the service did operate a walk-in element to it, but because they hadn't followed the referral procedure exactly, they were turned away. Each individual example can seem to be relatively small, but the overall impact, which occurs literally hundreds, if not thousands of times a day across the system, has an overall effect of producing certain people that have the most need and the most difficulty accessing the service face the most barriers. And then the other part of it is in terms of how the health service is resourced and where the priorities lie. So first of all, we have a health service that's very heavily invested in specialist services and hospital-based services rather than community-based services compared to some other countries. That does mean that we have access to fantastic technology, and I'm not in any way decrying the importance of specialist services. We all need them sometimes. But I think we've got the balance wrong in terms of how much we invest in healthcare that's close to people, close to communities. So that, for example, for someone traveling to a pain clinic that's three bus journeys away, basically because that's where the investment is in a centralized, specialized service, then that presents a barrier to them. And within community spending, certainly in general practice, spending reflects need reflects demand rather than need. So those areas of service that have high demand tend to be reflected in figures as attracting weighting in terms of funding. That means that those that already are demanding of services tend to attract funds. Those who, for whatever reason, are not demanding of services but have high needs, perhaps through learned hopelessness, through resignation, that's not captured by the way in which we weight funding. So if you look at how GP practices are funding, for example, there's a flat level of funding across GP practices, regardless of those practices that have high need and low life expectancy and high index of deprivation. In other words, deprivation doesn't attract resource towards those areas in terms of community-based health funding, but funding tends to be the same, flat across. And Professor Mercer and others have produced research that shows that patients consulting with GPs in areas classified as deprived have higher levels of stress and less amount of time per problem because of resources don't follow need. I could go on and on and on, but I hope that just gives a few sort of snapshots of what I mean by the institutional way in which the health service widens the health inequalities gap.
No, that's very helpful. It's very helpful to have your first-hand experience there. Can I bring in Paul O'Kane? And just a reminder to all of you remotely that if you want to add to anything anyone else has said or come in, please just use the chat box so that I can see that you want to come in. Put an R in the chat box and I'll bring you in. But otherwise, we'll probably direct our questions to individuals. Paul.
Thank you very much, convener, and thank you to the panel for your insights. Very helpful. I suppose what I want to ask is really about progress. Professor Marmot's work, and indeed I think a lot of what all panellists referred to, very often strikes me is that a lot of this isn't new and isn't rocket science, perhaps. It's about trying to look at what works in communities and to invest. And I think particularly a lot of that, which is provided already by very often local council services or by third sector. And I think across the piece, there has been a reduction in funding for those sorts of services. And obviously we can argue about the politics in here of the source of that. But I really just want to get a sense of, despite that backdrop, has there been progress made in Scotland in terms of implementing many of these strategies? And maybe start with Professor Marmot, if that's possible.
Yes, of course. But forgive me, I'm going to make the same conditional comment that I made right at the beginning. I've been studying England much more than I've been studying Scotland. So, but as I said at the beginning, I think you can say what applies to England applies to Scotland. East action. So what I described is a really miserable picture at national level, with policies going in an adverse direction from the point of view of health inequalities. The signs of hope come from cities and regions. In 2010, Coventry declared itself a Marmot city. They took my six domains of recommendations and implemented them. Now, this is not a randomized controlled trial, so the evidence of effect is at best suggestive. But that said, they saw improvement in early child development. They saw a reduction in the number of young people not in education, employment, or training. There was an increase in the people earning a real living wage. There was reduction in crime. So there were indicators suggesting that things were moving in the right direction. Since then, Greater Manchester said, well, if Coventry can be a Marmot city, we can be a Marmot city region. So we produced a report, Build Back Fairer, in Greater Manchester. 3 weeks ago, we produced a report working with colleagues in Cheshire and Merseyside. We're now working in Lancashire and Cumbria. Yesterday, I was in Newcastle upon Tyne. I'm getting closer to Scotland. I was in Newcastle upon Tyne, and we look like we're going to start a program of work with the north of Tyne region. Gwent wants to be the first Marmot region, realist cities and regions in acting on the evidence and exactly what Petra laid out. She and I would say, are on the same page. And so what she was saying with regard to Scotland is very similar to what I've been saying with regard to England and Wales. Real interest and action at local level. It does not let national governments off the hook. There's much that they should be doing and are not doing. But there's real interest in taking action. And in a way, it's an experiment. If child poverty is going up because of decisions made by the Chancellor of the Exchequer, what can cities and regions do to redress that problem? And in a way, it's an experiment. But there's real interest in pursuing it.
To come in.
I couldn't hear to you.
We can hear you fine.
Okay, fine. So yeah, I just wanted to add a little bit about my sort of fairly recent Scottish experience. I only moved up a year and a half ago, and I think there are significant differences in the way the Scottish Government talks about inequalities and the way it does policy, which are very promising. You know, we hear a lot about wellbeing economy approaches, community wealth building, things like thinking about a minimum income guarantee. So whilst these haven't yet had the chance to translate into health inequality impact, you know, and we've been in an extraordinary situation, so it would have been hard for any of this to push through, you know, enough in the times of COVID and so on. I think they are the right things to do, and to go for it, you know, full out and think about what do we need to do to increase the well-being of the Scottish population and redress the inequalities is the right thing. So I can see a lot of movement in the right direction, and also the way concerns about climate change and sustainability are increasingly present in conversations around, you know, when you talk to someone about mental health, or if you talk to someone about inequalities in income, you know, that triangle between health, the economy and sustainability is, I think, much better understood in Scottish government. So one would hope that will translate into real changes. At the moment, maybe the focus is too much on mitigation rather than the root causes, I would say. You know, a lot of, if you think about the extra child payment, that is really important. And I'm not saying do anything to stop it. But, you know, whilst that gets some more money into poorer households' pockets, it does not per se do anything to address income inequalities. So thinking about, you know, what is the thing that you can do with your money that will have the most long-lasting consequences, I think is going to be really, really important.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Dr. McDade.
Just in terms of trying to get a kind of a long-term view, I mean, looking at the Scottish Health Survey and the information we have on, say, the Warwick and Edinburgh mental health wellbeing scores, is very consistent across from 2008 to 2013 to 2019. The score is virtually the same, you know, which is telling us that we're not really, weren't even before the pandemic, we weren't making the progress that we might hope for. And so I do think that we need to redouble efforts. The pandemic has only worsened mental health inequalities. You know, it's introduced, you know, whole new categories of groups of individuals who are being affected by mental health problems that weren't necessarily a focus before, you know, including the health workforce itself. So we do need, I think, to be realistic about this, that it's a big effort, it's a long-term effort. And as I mentioned before, I think we have green shoots, we have the signs of the kinds of things that will make a difference. But we do need, as other speakers have said, to make sure that the kind of magnitude of the effort is equivalent to the disparity that exists.
And can I bring in Dr. Costin?
I think probably in answer to the question, I'd like to bring forward sort of three signs of progress. One for me, which has been a shift in thinking, has been to recognise that the health service and the wider factors affecting health inequalities are not two distinct things. There used to be a sort of divide between that approach. Over the last year, the report on health inequalities in primary care has very much looked at how integrated the wider community factors that affect health and health services are with one another. I think the Community Link Worker Programme, which started and now is spread across GP practice across Scotland, is a first sign of that sense of possible integration between how communities are vital for health and how healthcare support is there to support communities and not to deliver health. And I believe the pandemic has perhaps hastened along the idea that healthcare services can be there as an asset within the community alongside other assets, and that we can grow together to produce wellbeing communities, and that we're not somehow distinct things. And I'd like to really emphasize how much I feel that needs to be the way forward through community wealth building, through sustainability, and through an assets-based and a wellbeing community-based approach to health that invests in primary care, general practice, district nursing, community mental health services, alongside communities as part of the assets in the community, not as somehow in some distinct box. I think the second sign of hopefulness for me has been really the centrality that mental health now has in thinking. I think mental health is critical to health inequalities. I think the choices that we make in our life and the way that we respond to our environment and to our circumstances has a massive impact on our life expectancy and our disability. And helping people to have the resilience within the pressures that they're under is absolutely critical. To say mental health, the way that it's organized presents huge barriers to people, particularly people that have addiction problems or the people that are engaging in behaviors which were perhaps adaptive to their circumstances but are damaging to their health. And I still think we have a lot of discrimination and barriers built into mental health. And I hope that the mental health strategy, to me, that is kind of progress towards making mental health absolutely central to health inequalities. And I think finally, for me, the inclusion of people themselves in commenting on mental health and in helping to develop mental health policy has to be critical. I think the involvement of Chance to Change in the Health Inequalities Report of Primary Care has to be critical to how we understand and plan, and for me that's a big sign of progress. So that's just the thoughts about how we're making progress, or at least green shoots.
Thank you. Before I hand back to Paul, Professor Marmot wants to come back in.
Yeah, to pick up the theme that others have mentioned. When I remember going to a meeting in Murrayfield, I have no idea what the meeting was about, but I remember it was in Murrayfield. It was memorable. And listening to Scottish ministers speak, I said to colleagues, what the ministers are saying is far more likely to address health inequalities than what I'm hearing ministers say in London. And I had a similar feeling about Wales. What I've had quite a bit to do with the Welsh Government, I would say their policies should be far more likely to improve health and reduce health inequalities than the policies coming out of Westminster. And I look at Wales and I look at Scotland, and the health inequalities are deeper in Scotland and Wales than they are in England. So that then raises a question, what's going on? Are these policies not being put into place? Are they insufficient to address the deep-seated causes of health inequalities? It is amazing if I get an answer to that question, because it relates to what are you going to do next? If you've got the right policies, they haven't been applied deeply enough and for long enough. Or are there other things that need to be addressed?
Can I come back to Paul?
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I suppose on that last point, you know, I do wonder if when we, I think that's correct. I think there are lots of aspirational policies that seek to try and alleviate these issues. But I think it's in terms of the devolution down into local authorities, you know, for me, looking at the six priorities outlined by Professor Marmot, many of them are, you know, what local councils do around education, around employability and in terms of building communities. And I wonder if ongoing and repeated cuts to local authority budgets have an impact. And maybe if I could just get a sense from Professor Marmot how Coventry or Manchester dealt with what was obviously a reducing picture. And is it your sense that these things will be hard to achieve unless local government is funded appropriately?
Oh, very much so. Again, forgive me for talking about England, but if you look at the funding to local government in the decade after 2010, in the least deprived 20% of areas, the spending per person went down by 16%. And then the greater the deprivation, the greater the reduction. In the most deprived quintile, the spending per person went down by 32%. So if you're in Greater Manchester, in one of the more deprived local authorities, there are 10 local authorities in GM, the reduction in funding in excess of 40%. That makes everything much more challenging. And so money's not everything, but it's not nothing. It makes everything much more challenging. And so the context in which we're operating in those regions is, what can you do with that reduced level of funding? And that's the challenge. It's not that they wouldn't like more money from the centre, but as Petra said, the levelling up budget for 2021 in the north of England was £33 per person. Over the decade from 2010, the amount of money taken away annually was £413 per person. So levelling up, you give 33 quid, but you've taken away 413, and that's levelling up. And by contrast, what happened in Germany, as Petra laid out, is two orders of magnitude greater. So this isn't serious. And that withdrawal of funding is really serious. So we're operating with severe headwinds at local level.
Can I bring in Professor Meyer?
I just wanted to add that what you find is that the local authority model is obviously, you can do a lot, and a lot of these things are under the control of local authorities, but it also introduces a lot of variation and a lot of repetition in learning the same things, trying out the same things, and unless you've got a really strong evaluation framework and people who have the time to do that, I think it does introduce a lot of redundancy and a lot of extra costs. So I do think sort of cities and local areas are the way forward, but we need to find a way where you sort of do it in a more systems way, where you really think about, what are you trying to achieve? What are things that everybody can agree on trying out, rather than sort of letting everybody go away? The other is, of course, that local authorities are very differently funded. And, some people have got five officers working on economic strategy development and so on. Others have got just the one person who's sort of half time on it. So it introduces new inequalities in terms of those areas that have got larger resources to do evaluation, to go put in funding bids and so on. So I think we need to be careful that we, with our sort of health in place and localism, we don't make things worse rather than better by having some kind of overarching strategy, maybe at the Scottish Government level. I'm a bit worried that what I see is a lot of really, really good ideas and a lot of areas trying out many innovative things, but in a way that maybe isn't as well coordinated and can lead to quite different experiences for people who live in different areas. And we've all heard about postcode lottery and so on, and we shouldn't let it come to that.
Stephanie, can I bring you in? Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, convener. I just wanted to go back to something that Dr. Costin said earlier on that I think really gets to the heart of the issues that we're looking at here. I talked about the fact that those most in need are often the people that are making less demands, and about learned hopelessness. Now, clearly, you know, these are the people that we really need to be able to reach into those communities and actually touch these people if we want them to be healthy in their 50s or 60s or whatever. So I'm really interested in any comments that any of the others have on that there. But really, mainly, what key recommendations would you like to see this health committee make in its report to actually address this? Thanks.
Dr. Costin.
Yes, thank you. And I think obviously I echo what's been said about funding. But I think earlier the comment was made about how stigma and the personal impact of health inequalities are so critical. And I think there's learned hopelessness and resignation amongst people who are living with health inequalities. I think there's also kind of learned helplessness in health service providers, which turns into a stigmatization and a turning back on the individual, almost a blaming of people for their own problems. And I think that's something that is really toxic within health services and something that we need to recognize. So in terms of specific recommendations, one of the recommendations that the Short Life Working Group on Primary Care Health Inequalities has made has been around fellowships for healthcare professionals working in community around understanding trauma, understanding health inequality, understanding the practical skills that are needed to enable people to access preventative healthcare and to access being able to make interventions that will impact on their health. So I'd like to recommend that as a practical policy suggestion. Coming from Chance to Change, from the partner group with the Short Life Working Group, they've really emphasised how transformative peer support is within communities. Within my own practice, we have had two peer support groups for people that experience loneliness, marginalisation, disability, addiction. Within the community, there are other peer support groups through the Addictions Network, through a group for men. These groups have a really tremendous impact in terms of advocating for people, helping people to develop self-belief, helping people to believe that they need, that they matter, that their health is something that matters, that they themselves matter. So secondly, I'd like to really ask the committee to support the development of peer support within communities to allow people to use those assets to really improve their sense of agency and their sense of actually being entitled to healthcare and to better health. And part of that has been peer support to become digitally included. I think we have to recognise that the next 10, 20 years health services and health itself is going to be transformed through digital technologies. Digital exclusion is going to become a massive factor in terms of leaving people behind. The peer support for digital inclusion programmes, I think, are something else that I'd like to ask the committee to consider as being important in helping people to access healthcare.
Thank you. Can I bring in Dr. McDade, who wants to answer your question, Stephanie?
Sorry, you've come to me, have you? My screen froze there for just a second.
Yes, I did. Thank you.
Thank you. I suppose two things I would say about this question of, you know, why is there lower demand in areas of higher need? One is it makes me think about the perspective of people who are from a Black or ethnic minority background. Because what we hear when we talk to representatives of different ethnic minority communities is that they don't, first of all, they don't necessarily name their experience in this Western way of being a mental illness or, you know, anxiety or depression, you know, those diagnostic categories. And so so they don't necessarily, you know, they're not necessarily looking for a mental health service to try and help with their situation. And then when they do try and seek help, then they may be met with a service that is not really at all respectful of and sensitive to and willing to really try to understand how they themselves experience their distress and what it means for them and how it fits in with their culture. So we have heard that recently from engagement with ethnic minority communities, you know, minoritized communities. And I think we need to see mental health services that are not dependent so much on the family member identifying that they have a child or a relative who has something that might require mental health care, because that's an access route that might in itself be a barrier for people. I think the other thing is, it just calls to mind, and this is, you know, I'll be honest, a bit more speculation than evidence, but I do think that a lot of people who are living with mental distress have a high level of tolerance. And, you know, they don't necessarily see their situation as something where they will come forward for help. Particularly when we see in the context of the pandemic that many people experienced a time when the health services were not so available. And, you know, we know that the health service staff are under huge stress and strain. I'm thinking here particularly, say, of carers. I'm thinking of people with disabilities who are so resourceful and may not see themselves as people who are deserving of receiving a mental health intervention. But these are also people who are at high risk of isolation, of loneliness, and of mental health difficulties because of those factors. So I do think that we need more outreach and messaging and availability of those low level and community-based supports that are easy access for people, so that they don't see it as a big hurdle that they have to, you know, even that they would have to go to a GP and seek help, and then from the GP go on to, you know, a specialist service, which in itself is quite a high bar for getting low level support.
And can I bring in Professor Marmot?
Thank you. Responding to the question about learned helplessness, I hear a lot of discussion about poverty of aspirations. And my response to poverty of aspirations is it's a legitimate analysis of the poverty of opportunity. You can't say, well, the problem is young people don't have aspirations if they have no opportunities to do anything with them. Growing up in grinding poverty with little prospects for the future, learned helplessness is a reasonable response to that. So we, in a way, can't deal with learned helplessness without improving the prospects, the legitimate prospects of education, employment, services, and so on. And the second linked comment is it's incredibly intellectually taxing to be poor. And if you're not poor, it's pretty easy to get through the day. You are hungry, you eat something. The fridge is empty, you go shopping. The rent's paid by direct debit or whatever. It's just, you don't have to think about any of those things. Being poor is really intellectually taxing. You've got to think about that all day. As one commentator said, you know, if you go into the pen, That takes a long time. You've got to tot up the prices and look. It could take 45 minutes. If you come in with £75 to spend, you're in and out in 15 minutes. So it's incredibly taxing intellectually to be poor. And then to blame people in that situation that they're not thinking medium and long term is a woeful misunderstanding of the intellectual mental cost of poverty.
Stephanie, you want to follow up?
Thanks very much, Convener. So a wee bit of a separate question, I suppose, for Professor Meyer. You spoke about the Scottish experience being significantly different and it being very, very encouraging there. Talked as well about seeing lots of momentum that's going in the right direction. And you also mentioned that there was too much mitigation rather than root causes. So I'm wondering, what can we do in Scotland with the limited powers that are available to us to actually tackle those root causes? Because at times, you know, it does feel like we're limited to mitigating a policy that's coming from the UK government. Thanks.
Professor Meyer.
Yeah, I mean, I know what you're saying. There are a lot of powers that are not devolved, but there are examples such as council tax, for example, which could be made much more efficient. At the moment, a higher proportion of poorer households' budgets are going on things like council tax. So having a look across public sector spending, whether there are things that you can change. Education is another. You know, education systems are very unequal still in Scotland. Are there things that you can proactively recommend is being done? You know, things around the green economy, thinking about, you know, how do you create the kind of jobs that are good jobs, decent pay, decent conditions, and target them at areas where there's the most need. So I think if you look across all functions that Scottish Government has available, there are a large number of areas around, especially education, employment, which would be very helpful if they were mindful of the need to reduce inequalities. Because yeah, that gap between health inequalities is one kind of inequality, and economic and social inequalities are something different. I think that is a barrier at the moment. That you know, if you go to sustainability folk, there isn't always that consideration of how do we multi-solve the different problems that we have. You know, how do you optimize between all the different goals that you have in your national performance framework, which, you know, I wholeheartedly agree with. It's a very strong framework, but that kind of how do we hit the things that maybe aren't the perfect solution for one thing, but that help us address three other things that we also want to gain at the same time, and really going for inequality reductions in all that you do is going to be incredibly important.
Okay, and just Dr. Kirsten, I think you wanted to come in. I didn't spot it just before Stephanie asked that second question. I imagine it's for their first.
Yeah, thank you. It's maybe just to reflect a kind of feeling of discomfort around the term we've been using of learned helplessness, and perhaps to echo what Sir Michael said. I think this isn't to somehow suggest that the kind of locus of failure lies within communities, and that they need to be somehow rescued from that situation. I think the most powerful advocates for enablement and for helping people to feel that they deserve help come from within communities themselves. And in many ways, structures, public sector, health service, I speak for specifically, are the barriers to that. I know that in health service planning, the third sector is very much not an equal partner, and that peer groups and patient groups and communities really within NHS planning are not equal partners with the health sector. So in many ways, I think that we need to take away the barriers to communities and to people advocating from within communities, rather than saying that somehow it's a kind of helplessness that they've taken on themselves. In many ways, we create that through our systems. And I just really wanted to come back on that phrase. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Tess White? Thank you. I have actually found this morning really, really interesting and learnt a lot. So thank you to the panellists. And I do have a question, but Dr. Corson talked about creating the systems to step, and I've summarised, to step onto the pavement. And then there was a general theme talking about local assets and infrastructure. Dr. McDade talked about the impact of the loss of local libraries. And Dr. Marmot talked about a state of helplessness. In developing resilience and the reasonable prices that Dr. Mayer talked about, my question is there a single practical, and realise it's really complex, but is there a single practical action that would have a dramatic impact, such as our last meeting, we talked about sport and sport on the agenda, and there was this theme about opening up school estates to communities to improve the issue of local health equality. So if it's not, I mean, firstly, the question is, what's your thought about a single action like opening up school estates to the community so that the assets are available? And if not that, is there something else that each of the panellists would think would be something better?
Okay. I think you're initially wanting to hear from Dr. Coston, is that right?
Yes, that would be
okay, great. Thank you.
I guess for me, what has kind of driven me throughout my career has been a belief that well-being communities are where health happens. So I think a long-term commitment to communities wrapped around health services as the place where we make the change around health inequalities, I suppose that's not too broad an answer. Many community assets have short-term funding and live very precarious lives. If they had the same level of commitment and support that the public sector does, then I think we could make a huge difference to health inequalities, if that's integrated in with health services and not seen as a separate thing, and across all sectors integrated into the community.
Thank you. And Petra Meyer wants to come in.
Oh, yes, now I'm unmuted. I'm a system scientist, so coming up with one particular action is always going to be particularly difficult for me, because that's, you know, I'm trained to think about what are the systems effects that we need to change, what are the key levers. But I think a fair wage for everyone has to be one of the key things. In work, poverty is just a real problem. So whatever you can do to increase the national minimum wage or make sure that more people get paid the real living wage, I think is going to be a good way out of poverty. And then all the different things that poverty or being on low incomes influences, which are massive. That would be my wish list item.
Thank you. And can I come to Dr. McDade?
In the fortunate position of being able to agree with my two colleagues there who've spoken before. So I absolutely agree with Dr. Coston that, you know, building the community assets, building the spaces where communities can come together and engage and support, and ensuring that those spaces are inclusive. So school spaces might be attractive for some people, but not attract other sections of the community. So I think it's really, really important that we're really taking a community development approach to how we identify which spaces need to be developed, and that we're doing that in partnership with the diversity of the communities involved. And then I agree with Dr. Meyer, Professor Meyer, but I'm aware that the Scottish government is exploring a minimum income guarantee. And our own research on the effects of a universal basic income, definitely, you know, from the evidence that's there so far, is saying that reducing the conditionality on social welfare benefits is key to them boosting people's mental health. It's not enough to just have more money in someone's pocket, but it has to be done in such a way that they don't still have huge hoops to go through to, you know, to try to get access to that income. So we have, you know, I think that introducing that minimum income guarantee in the right way, so that it really is as reducing as much of the conditionality as possible, could be very helpful.
Thank you. And I bring in Professor Marmot.
Thank you. It's tempting and it's attractive to ask what's the one thing. It's probably the second most common question I've been doing this. What's the one thing? But please don't go down that route. If there were only one thing, we'd all be doing it. If there's one thing, it's to put equity of health and well-being at the heart of all policy making, but not opening up sports facilities or as the one thing. There isn't. That's why, in my own case, we had six domains of recommendation, because we didn't think there was only one thing you could do. So none of the things that have been said are bad. They're all good. But there's more than one that has to be done.
Tess, do you want to follow up on any of that before I go
no,
to
No, that was very thorough.
Okay, thank you. Can I come to Evelyn Tweed?
Thanks, Convener. My question is for Dr. Costin. And Dr. Costin, can I say thank you for all your work that you've done in Drumchapel? I used to work there many years ago, so I know that the issues that you deal with and that your patients deal with, and I'm sure that they will very much be feeling the benefit of your commitment. I'm interested in the internal NHS barriers that you talked about, you know, that patients have to navigate through. How can we do this better? What recommendations would you have for us?
Thank you. First of all, I think I talked earlier about the kind of boundary between hopelessness and rage. And I think engaging with Chance to Change has been actually a process of people uncovering their rage and actually coming back to my own practice with a sense of grievance and hurt at the barriers that we place to them, for example, through difficulties in accessing appointments, through difficulties in accessing our services and so on. So I'm not speaking as if I'm somehow pointing the finger at other services. And actually, it also, I think, points towards a shift in the dynamic of power between us, that allowing Chance to Change a really involved process of questioning the service that we offer is bringing them to a position at the moment that feels uncomfortable because they're questioning. But actually, to me, points towards this is where the solution lies, in allowing people to question and to actually hold up to the light the barriers that they face. There's almost too many barriers to mention. I've given some kind of examples of them, but I think a shift in which people are able to question those barriers and to have more of a say in how services are redesigned needs to be the way that for going forward. And that is a painful and uncomfortable process. I'm finding it personally uncomfortable because I want to be defensive and say, well, I'm trying my hardest and you should see all the pressures we're under. and going to other services to question how they operate likewise elicits or can elicit a defensive reaction in terms of everyone is trying their best, no one's trying to be. But I think learning to set aside that discomfort and to have very difficult conversations about how we do things to understand the barriers people face, to me that feels like a healthier health service. And actually, I'm not sure it is a zero-sum game. I think all the barriers we put up make us inefficient. And all the things that we do to try and protect our resources actually make us inefficient. And I think, I suspect that operating in a way that's less defensive of resource and more trusting of people and more willing to bring people in I suspect would make a healthier and more efficient health service. The direction of travel has been very much down fragmentation, making services more and more divided, have more and more types of services. Mental health, for example, there seem to be dozens of different teams and options for mental health, each of which has their own inclusion and exclusion criteria, each of which has their own hurdles to get through. I think redesigning services around people would make us more efficient. So I think it maybe seems a bit utopian, but to me that feels like the way that we need to go as a health service. I think the last 10 years have been very much focused around living within budgets and defending services and defending budgets. And I suspect that that has actually made us less efficient because each little part of the health service is trying to meet its own little part of the budget by defending it against all comers. And that is not a healthy way for a health service to run. So I don't know if that answers the question, but I'm certainly not trying to point fingers at other services. We're all struggling to be inclusive in this way. And perhaps finally, it is also about attitude and about culture, and not as health workers getting ground down and just feeling under fire all the time. I think a lot of people just feel that they're under attack and are just doing their best to get through the day in whatever way possible. And that can be quite discriminatory against the people that feel more challenging or have more need. It's easier to see easy people and much harder to see hard people. So if you're going to get through the day, and keeping out the people that have got the really complicated, difficult, challenging, unsolvable problems can be a way of getting through the day intact, but that's not the way to go, and that just stores up more problems.
Evelyn, do you get any follow-up? I know you wanted to ask about intersectionality before. I don't know if you, now's the time you want to do that, but I'm happy to go to another member if that's not the case. I don't want to put you on the spot. I can go to Sandesh and come back to you. Sandesh.
Okay. Thank you, convener. Can I just say to Professor Marmot, I remember reading everything you were doing at med school, and it is great to be able to see you and speak to you. I have a question for Professor Meyer. Now, I believe you founded the Sheffield Alcohol Research Group, and alcohol impacts those more deprived the most, and it's we know this. Through all the work that not only you have done, but we have seen. We've had two reports come out on alcohol and minimum alcohol pricing in Scotland, including one today, and both present evidence that minimum alcohol pricing is not working, with the most vulnerable cutting back to buy food, especially those of spirits. What is your response to this, and how can we ensure that the impact of alcohol is not felt so greatly in those areas of most deprivation?
Yeah, I mean, I think we need to say that I don't quite agree that the policy isn't working. It's working on the whole. There are some very heavy drinkers who have, who may not have the opportunity to cut down their drinking, who then substitute for food spending. I don't think that's a problem of the price you put on alcohol. I think it's a problem on the health services that haven't been available. The addiction services have had major cutbacks during COVID. They've been virtually inaccessible unless you were able to join online groups and, make do with things like Alcoholic Anonymous online and so on. So when you get to these very dependent drinkers, we have seen that, I mean, it hasn't had many detrimental effects, but there has been some substitution with food purchases. And I should say I wasn't involved in that particular study, but I mean, I didn't see anything that sort of would make me majorly concerned that the policy wasn't working as intended, because we have seen alcohol consumption fall, we have seen alcohol mortality and hospital admissions fall. So I think it's more around putting protective structures in place, and those have failed during COVID. So it's again sort of that thinking about what you need in the round for a policies to work for all the people you want it to work for. Going back to cheap alcohol is certainly not something that I would advocate. I think minimum unit pricing is one of the stronger policies that that the Scottish Government has come up with in the absence of having full tax controls. You know, obviously having a very sensible duty system is another thing that you would do if you were an independent country, but failing that minimum pricing, pushing up the bottom prices and making sure it's not pocket money alcohol is very important. And, you know, it really only affects very high alcohol content spirits, which are very damaging to health. That's what I would say. You know, it's let's put the health structures in place rather than say the policy isn't working.
Sandesh.
Thank you. I mean, with respect, alcohol consumption fell in those who were not deprived. We saw that, and we actually saw alcohol consumption with those who have a problem going up. We also saw alcohol consumption going up in those people who are most vulnerable. And a report by Public Health Scotland found no clear evidence of reduction in alcohol consumption among people drinking at harmful levels following the implementation of minimum alcohol pricing. And I think you're absolutely right. There is no, there's been a collapse of recovery services, and that's key. You know, anything that we introduce is key to doing that. And we've also found that those who are drinking are just switched what they're drinking. And as I said in my first question, so looking at the UK government's policy, where they have increased the taxes at the alcohol based on the alcoholic level. So you're seeing spirits with increased tax and those weaker alcohols with lower tax thresholds. So 3.5%, for example, and looking at low and no alcohol as well. So is this something that we should be promoting, low and no alcohol? And should we be looking at maybe trying to introduce systems which don't just look at pricing? And it's because, you know, looking at health inequalities, this is a huge area that doesn't seem to quite be working.
Yeah, I mean, I think, as I say, the DG reforms are very welcome and much overdue. They don't balance out a loss of duty increases over recent years. We had the duty escalator, and that seemed to be working well, and then that was abandoned. And now there is that shift in the duty system to penalise some very strong alcohols, which is good and welcome. In terms of what should Scottish Government do, I think, you know, I mean, there's a lot of international evidence on alcohol pricing working in terms of reducing consumption. It also shows that very heavy drinkers reduce their consumption by less on average, because there is a dependency factor. So I would treat them as separate. There is something to be said about minimum unit pricing, which is a policy that makes alcohol less accessible to young people, that, you know, sort of makes it gives a strong message that, you know, cheap alcohol is not a good thing to have in your society. Taxation works across the board of alcohol consumption, so having something that is strength-linked is very important. And as I said, it needs to be as part of a suite of policies which also tackle, you know, the reasons for heavy alcohol consumption, often linked into mental health issues. So having good mental health support, having good alcohol support. The evidence on the link between alcohol pricing, alcohol availability, and health outcomes is very, very strong internationally and also in Scotland.
Okay. Thank you.
One further question, but can I address this, Dr. Corson? It's something that you said earlier about how there's a standard amount of money going into general practice. Am I mistaken in thinking initially GPs who worked in areas of high deprivation actually did get more money, more funding, but following the introduction of the new GP contract, we've seen that it's linked. There is an element of deprivation, but actually more money is going into those elderly, those who are living with complex needs, and that has thus reduced the money going into areas of deprivation.
Thank you. I probably need to qualify my reply in that I'm not a health economist and I'm not an academic in this field, so I'm having to quote others on this. The work of Professor Watton and Professor Mercer before the 2018 change in the GP contract didn't find that there was a gradient towards deprived areas. So though there was a deprivation weighting factor in how funding was allocated, the actual end product in terms of funding to practices, as I understand it, was flat across practices. So there wasn't a weighting. That's my understanding of their research. I may be wrong on that. As I say, I'm a frontline GP rather than an academic. Since the 2018 contract, the way in which funding was weighted changed. I don't know whether that has made the situation worse, but certainly I understand that the Audit Commission has found that that hasn't funded towards areas of higher need, so that the funding structure is still flat across GP practices. So I'm afraid that's the level of my knowledge on the subject, and that's who I've been quoting. But I suspect you'd probably need someone who had a better understanding of GP funding at a macro level to drill down to that in greater depth.
Thank you. Can I bring in Professor Marmot?
Thank you. Just to come back on alcohol, my understanding, and Petra can correct me if I've not got it up to date. My understanding is, if you look globally, there's a clear correlation between mean alcohol consumption and alcohol-associated harm. And secondly, price relates to consumption. So that all to the good, and I think that fits with what Petra said. Within Britain, in general, mean consumption is higher in higher socioeconomic groups. The gradient goes the other way, but alcohol-associated harm goes the expected way. The more deprived, the greater the frequency of hospital admissions and the greater the mortality related to alcohol. So that it in a way is a bit like I was saying with COVID. You need to control the vector, alcohol, you need to control the virus, but you also need to deal with inequalities, because it's clear that the link between alcohol and alcohol-associated harm is stronger in people of lower socioeconomic position.
Thank you. Could I maybe go to Gillian Mackay, who's joining us online for some questions. Gillian.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. To what extent are health services trauma-informed, and what improvements need to be made in this area, and how do we ensure that all public services take a trauma-informed approach? And could I maybe come to Dr. Costin first?
Yes, and thank you very much for that question, because I think it does get to the heart of a lot of what we've been talking about. Including the discussion about alcohol, I guess there's a reason as to why some people suffer greater harm, not only from alcohol consumption, but from consumption of all kinds of addictive substances, including nicotine and other drugs. My feeling or my experience over my time in Drumchapel is that there is a very widespread experience of trauma in communities, both from childhood adverse experiences and from adverse experiences growing up, and from day-to-day issues of facing poverty or exclusion or gender-based violence or ethnicity-related discrimination and so on. I'm not sure that health services are very trauma-informed. I think many of the behaviours that are adaptive, that people have learned as a way of coping with trauma and of dealing with the wider world are experienced as difficult and are, in a sense, people are shunned because of those ways of behaving or expressing themselves rather than trying to understand what lies behind the behavior. I think to take alcohol, for example, people that are alcohol dependent may present to health services in ways that are very difficult. Ambulances on Saturday nights and attendances at A&E and perhaps behaviour in hospitals that is challenging or behaviour at the front desk in a GP practice that is challenging. So I think part of what I've been talking about in terms of stigma and in terms of how people are dealt with and how we understand people has to do with every person who works in the health and social care setting, both in community and in specialist level, need to have a better understanding of how trauma impacts throughout the life and how that affects people's behaviour. So I think there has been steps taken towards that. I think there is more availability, trauma-informed training, for example, which we've had in our GP practice at some of our protected learning afternoons. But I think we still have a very, very long way to go. And not least understanding the ways in which we re-traumatise people, particularly through the ways in which people try to access help and mental health and the kind of barriers and repeated assessments they have to go through and being told repeatedly that they don't fit this service and they don't fit that service as a way of kind of re-traumatising. So as well as individual understanding trauma, it's also how do the systems and barriers in place reinforce trauma for people.
Gillian. Oh, Gillian, can I bring in Dr. McDade? She's just said that she wants to come in this, and then I'll come back to her for a follow-up question. Dr. McDade.
Thanks, and thank you again for the question around trauma-informed practice. And our view would definitely be that this trauma-informed approach needs to be embedded in health services, definitely, but also extended to other services, public services like social security services, like housing services. The other aspect of this is, I mean, I'm certainly aware of the government's wider kind of trauma-informed workforce program, but I think the concern is if it ends up being a once-off training around trauma-informed approach. And then someone is supposed to kind of, as we've talked about, kind of go back into their system of working and just carry on trying to remember what they learned in that one-off training session or training program. Actually, what we need is somewhat of I think, what Dr. Costin was talking about, but we need to embed reflective practice throughout service provision so that it's an ongoing reflection that happens and that space is provided for public sector professionals, health service staff, to be able to reflect on how the experience that they're creating and coming into contact with in their services. So embedding reflective practice, is the next step, is a step that needs to accompany the kind of the training programs and education in trauma-informed approach.
Thank you. I'll go back to Gillian.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks both for your answers there. We've touched on various different factors that might have a stigma attached to them. So in what ways, if any, do current working practices in health and other public services entrench stigma? And further to what you've already said, what work needs to be done to address this at the heart of the services that we're talking about? And could I maybe go back to Dr. Costin to start?
Yes, I think obviously at a superficial level, having trauma-informed practice training, I think is massively important. I think it ties in also to the shift in terms of the power structure and the extent to which the third sector and communities are involved in how services are designed and planned. I think having a much greater voice for people who have lived experience of exclusion or trauma or adverse childhood experiences in helping us to understand how we design health services is critical. Just to give an example, for video consultations, which many hospitals are now using and GP practices as well, but people who have had to attend court as witnesses for adverse childhood events or for exploitation or abuse, many have had to attend by a video link, and video interactions can be can raise issues around those experiences, and so they find video consultations quite traumatizing. That's something that I've just learned recently from talking to individuals. And I guess it's understanding the ways in which we design practices, and the only way we can do that is by bringing in people who themselves have lived experience to help us understand the design services around their needs. So I think, yes, train individuals, but more than anything, bring communities into designing services.
And can I bring in Professor Meyer?
Waiting for the microphone to unmute. Now, this is a bit of an anecdotal experience. I'm supporting Ukrainian refugees at the moment, and just the way you engage with services, and the sometimes very disrespectful way services deal with you, it's just heartbreaking. And you know, having that first-hand experience now of something that I've been studying sort of remotely for a while is really quite powerful to see. You know, that you're asked to come to a job centre which requires an hour and a half round trip on the bus just for you to be told that the person you were supposed to see wasn't there, and to come back the next day when, you know, you already have an interview, and then you say, well, you've got a job interview. Oh, no, you've got to attend. And, you know, things like that are just so, they take away your sense of agency of being able to control your fortunes in a way that is really demoralised. And I mean, and I know you will have heard many of these experiences from people with lived experience, but it's powerful to see what that constant onslaught of not being believed, of your time not being valued, of you know, you somehow being made to jump through various hoops to, I don't know, register with a dentist and even finding someone who will take you on, what that does and how much time and effort, as Michael already said, you know, it is a massive resource drain. And if you're already traumatized and have fled from war, it just makes life much, much more difficult. And I'm sure if you're in a situation where you're otherwise financially vulnerable or have experienced trauma, as so many Scottish residents have, it's just very, very hard to navigate the large number of services. I mean, there are great help and support programs, but they're all very bitty and they're not aligned, and there's no one-stop shop. So you've got to really be very informed and chase every single bit of support, and that is really hard work.
You've brought up something that we have heard a lot, Professor Meyer, about alignment of services and people not having to retell their story multiple times to multiple different people. I mean, I wonder if any of our other panelists have got reflections on that, because we've had some people suggesting solutions to some of that. I wonder if this is a good point to bring in maybe other panelists about that kind of aspect, which can compound people's trauma if you're having to say the same story over and over again to a different person from scratch, not leaving anything out in case it becomes a difficulty in accessing a service. Is that something that you must hear a lot, Dr. Cowson?
Yes, it is, and it's something which Chance to Change have very much brought into their commentary on the Short Life Working Group report. They actually developed a model which they would like to be introduced, certainly in primary care, but across the health service, which is see me, I'm a person with feelings, listen, my opinion matters, be honest, even if you don't know, help me understand, please don't tell me what to do. Remember, I'm an expert in your professional hands, 50-50 partnership, and consider peer support. People build confidence far more effectively than medication. I think actually going to people and asking them to teach us how to relate in a way that's enabling is absolutely critical to this. And certainly very strongly that repeated assessments to be told that you don't fit a service is a traumatizing experience for people that already face barriers, and we have to find a way to get rid of that. So basically, whatever door you go in, that's the only door you go in, even if it's another service that you need. The door you enter by is the single door, and even if you've moved on the more appropriate service, that is the door you enter by. You don't get kicked out the door and told to find another door to get in. I think that has to be a thing of the past.
Thank you, and that's very helpful as we think about what we're going to recommend in our report. Evelyn, on intersectionality, you want to come in. This will probably be the last sort of theme of questions, unless I'll be looking around my colleagues, see if they want to come in, but we really only have about 5-10 minutes left. Evelyn.
Okay. Thanks, Convener. We heard from a lot of people giving evidence that intersectionality is an issue and that they face multiple barriers because of this. What is being done in policy and practice terms to help, and to anyone who would like to come in?
We've got Dr. McDade offering to start us off.
Yes, thank you. So I'm not going to try to, I'm not an academic, so I'm not going to try to define intersectionality. But one of the activities that we've recently been engaged in the foundation is establishing a diverse experience advisory panel to the Scottish Government to inform the development of mental health policy. This is the first time that there will be a panel whose focus is on mental health policy, but for whom they don't necessarily have to have had a diagnosis of a mental health condition or experience of mental health services to be advising on mental health policy. So it's quite innovative in that way. And when we had quite a strong interest in participating in the panel, we had over 180 expressions of interest for a maximum of 30 places on the panel. But one of the things that we found was that many of the people coming forward who we had sought on the basis of, you know, have you had any experience of disadvantage or discrimination that might put you at risk of having a mental health problem, we found that lots of people came forward who had experiences that reflected intersectionality, that experiences of, you know, perhaps they had experienced unemployment, but also had not had a chance to fulfill their education, also had experience of single motherhood. We have people who have been victims of violence, but who also come from a refugee status, who've been a witness of violence in Scotland once they've arrived in Scotland. So I think when you ask people about what puts them at risk of a mental health problem, what we've found is that they can point to a whole number of different circumstances in their life that have where they've realized that it has caused them stress and distress and perhaps put them at risk. So I think intersectionality is fully alive in individuals' experience. And as Dr. Costin has pointed out, the only thing is that our systems are not designed for rounded human beings. Our systems are designed for people who fit a single category. And it's really needs to really shift. And just to note similarly that this was found also with regard to evidence that the Poverty Research, the Poverty Alliance, conducted. So we are partners with the Poverty Alliance in a project on poverty and mental health. And they had done research on people's experience of universal credit, Glasgow-based recipients' experience of universal credit, very much saying that what they needed was a much more person-centered service than what they were actually receiving.
Thank you. Can I come to Dr. Costin?
Yes, thank you. I guess I'd like to echo what Professor Marmot said earlier, that health inequalities and the climate emergency are the two great emergencies that we're facing in the next 10 years. I think if these were embedded at the heart of every system and every sector, both in the public and the private sector and the third sector, that we understood that these are the two great emergencies that will make the difference between a good future or catastrophic future and there was national leadership for that, then I think at least we'd be working towards the same goals and the same aims. So I'd just like to perhaps echo that, that these should be embedded in all sectors to help us to work across sectors towards the same aim rather than pulling in different directions.
Thank you, that's very helpful. And can I come to Professor Meyer?
Yeah, I wanted to just point out that a lot of the intersectionalities come because things are causally linked and because everything's in a system. So if you grow up poor, you're much less likely to have a good education that then has influences on the, you know, where you live in your adulthood, what kind of job you do, potentially whether you've got help with your childcare or whether you end up as a lone carer who's struggling for money. So a lot of these things, without, you know, sort of that stigmatizing life course perspective where it's all predetermined, but they are, you know, strongly linked. And, you know, if you grow up in poverty, your chances of overcoming poverty are much, much less likely in future things, and health consequences are there. So for me, intersectionality is around sort of a web of causes that all sort of stack up against having healthy life outcomes later in life. And as Peter said, you know, thinking about it in the round and thinking about how education and employment and housing and everything, you know, goes together to create these outcomes is going to be very, very important.
Thank you. That's all been very helpful and a good note to end on, because we very much agree with that the roots of health inequalities lie in a lot of different portfolios. And you've all made that extremely clear this morning. So thank you very much for that. We have reached the end of our time with you. So I want to thank our four panellists for the time spent with us this morning and for additional information that's been put in our chat box there for maybe following up on. Our next meeting on the 28th of June, the committee will be taking evidence from the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport as part and the final session on our inquiry into health inequalities, and we'll be scrutinising an affirmative SSI. But that does conclude the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.